The hanging curve to Mark McGwire, who hit a grand slam. He'd gone a week since his 50th home run. He hit two today. He's got 52 now. That's the most in the American League since Roger Maris and Mickey Mantle in 1961, when they hit 61 and 54. With the rash of offensive records being thrashed this season and still a week to go, baseball purists like myself have characterized the season as probably having should have been broadcast in animated form, so cartoonish have been some of the numbers put up. But despite the number of 30 and 40 home run hitters and back-to-back 50 homer seasons and single-season team records that have been shattered, no one has approached Roger Maris's 61 in 61. Keith Olbermann takes us back 35 years to the hardest part of achieving the game's greatest single-season record.
Roger Maris has now held the record for most home runs in a baseball season, longer than Babe Ruth did. And though the asterisk that demeaned his epic performance of 35 summers past is officially gone, its shadow remains. And people today barely know who Roger Maris was.
Roger was a great man, a great father, one of the greatest all-around baseball players I ever saw, and one of my best friends.
Well, Roger Maris is always going to be remembered for the 61 home runs. I don't think there's any doubt about that as far as the public is concerned and historians. But I guarantee you one thing, Roger Maris was one heck of a baseball player, and he was even a greater man.
But he was a man who had broken the Babe Ruth record in an expansion year and was written off as a one-season wonder. The first of the three tragedies of Roger Maris's life was, of course, that he was anything but a one-season wonder. Before his assault on Ruth, he'd already been voted the most valuable player in the American League at the age of 26. He would win the award for a second consecutive season in 1961. Between his rookie season of 1957 and his final season of 1968, only 9 players hit more homers. Only 12 drove in more runs. This despite the fact that only 4 times was Roger Maris healthy enough to get even 500 at-bats in a season. Hypotheticals are risky and annoying, but at the frequency with which Roger Maris connected, give him Hank Aaron's total of at-bats, and Roger Maris would have hit 667 home runs. And he did play in 6 World Series in 9 years, on 3 champions. He would drive in or score a total of 44 runs in 41 series games. The second of the tragedies of Roger Maris was the 1961 season itself. People loved to see Babe Ruth hit home runs. People loved to see Mickey Mantle hit home runs. Sometimes, people hated to see Roger Maris hit home runs.
He used to tell me about all the hate letters that he received from those who revered Ruth. That was understandable, but because another guy was trying to break his record, it was almost like he was desecrating an icon.
He'd get on the elevator, and there'd be 3 guys in the elevator and say, "Hey, I hope you don't do it. I hope you don't break the record. Babe Ruth is the greatest player ever."
There were those who thought Mantle was Ruth's rightful heir. There were those who thought no one was, such as the commissioner, Ford Frick, who as a sports writer had ghostwritten for Ruth in the 20s and 30s. On July 18, 1961, with Maris at 35 homers, 17 games ahead of Ruth's 1927 pace, Commissioner Frick announced that to actually break Ruth's record, a player would have to hit 61 homers in no more than the same number of games in which Ruth had played in 1927, 155. Of course, Ruth himself had originally broken Ned Williamson's 1884 record. Williamson had hit 27 homers in a 113-game season. Ruth had hit 29 in a 138-game season. Nobody went running for the asterisk then.
We didn't increase the schedule. We didn't have anything to do with it. All it was 61 to 60 home runs in a year you had to beat. And I don't care what it was. I mean, it had to be in a season.
I think there was a terrible injustice done to Roger Maris when Ford Frick put that asterisk behind his 61 home runs.
But more than just the asterisk, there were the reporters. For perhaps the first time, we saw the media swarming like white blood cells going for a germ.
Right up to game time, they felt that almost that I should be there for interviews.
In those days, they were just with you every second, and you didn't have any way to get away from it except when you went on the field to play ball. And I know he always felt like that was nice and peaceful to be able to get on the field.
And the Yankees gave him no protection either. They gave him no protection. He had no room set aside.
And then, of course, after the ball game, it made it difficult because I sat there until the last writer filtered in and went out. There was no organized period of a half hour, an hour, hour and a half. Hell, some days I was there 3-4 hours after a ball game, just sitting there with interviews, and it did get grueling. That really hurt. I was going through a lot of mental strain without really realizing what was happening. It was just, it snuck up on me. One day we're in Baltimore, and somebody said, gee, you got a lot of hair missing in the back of your head. Well, I can't see back there, so I didn't know.
Blotches of hair would fall out. It all came from nerves. The doctor assured him that it would grow back once this season was over.
Through September 9th, game number 143, Roger Maris had hit 56 homers. If he could hit 4 or 5 in the next 12 games, he would make Frick's asterisk unnecessary. But not for a week did number 57 come.
There's a drive to deep right, and there's number 57 off the top of the upper deck.
Then the next day, off ace Detroit closer Terry Fox to bust open a tie game in the 12th.
There's a drive. That might carry all the way. Bruton back. And it's number 58 for Roger Maris, his 58th home run of the year.
Roger Maris was now as close as anyone else had ever been. But he was already at game number 153. It passed without a homer, and so did 154. In game 155 came the 59th, but not the 60th. And according to the commissioner, the chase was over. Ruth's record was safe. And that's when it happened. That's when Roger Maris finally had enough.
He tells Ralph Hockey, says, I'm going to take a day off. I can't take any more of this stuff.
Which surprised a lot of people that he asked for a day off, because he never sat out of the lineup. And of course, he still had the chance of breaking the record when he did that.
And Hauk said, what do you mean you're going to take a day off? He says, I'm taking a day off. He says, I've had it. He said, Roger, what am I going to tell the press? He says, tell them I went fishing. And he left. And he went over and he spent the night with Whitey Herzog at Whitey's house in Baltimore.
After the brief escape, Maris returned, and against Herzog's Orioles, the record was tied.
There it is. If it stays fair, and it is number 60.
Because in April the Yankees had played a tie game, Maris now had 4 games left to get the 61st. It finally came in the last one against a Boston rookie, Tracy Stout.
Here's the windup. Fastball hit deep to right.
There are two ironic details about Maris's record. First, statistically, the pitchers off whom he hit his 61 home runs had more experience, had lower ERAs, and were pitching in bigger ballparks than had the pitchers off whom the Babe had hit his 60. 36 of Maris's 61 homers came off pitchers who had won at least 10 games that season. Ruth had hit just 33 off 10-game winners. In 1962, Roger Maris hit 33 home runs and drove in 100 runs. He didn't get as much as a single 10th place vote in the MVP balloting. After all, he hadn't broken Ruth's record again. The descent had begun. In 1965, Maris broke his hand. The Yankees didn't tell him. The Yankees didn't tell reporters. The Yankees didn't tell the fans. An injured Mickey Mantle, New York sympathized. An injured Roger Maris, New York doubted. Booed constantly for 2 years, Maris told the Yankees he would retire after the 1966 season. Instead, they traded him to St. Louis, where he guided the Cardinals to back-to-back pennants and then, at age 34, retired. The bitterness about New York and the record continued, but by 1984, it had faded enough that he finally returned to Yankee Stadium to have his uniform number 9 retired, but only after he had made a deal with George Steinbrenner, a deal for the kids.
You build a little league park down here for these kids in Gainesville, and that was the real capper, and Steinbrenner sent $20,000 or $30,000 down there, and they built a little league ballpark for the kids in Gainesville, Florida.
That day meant more than just a little league field. It would also prove to have been a farewell. For 17 months later came the last of the 3 tragedies of Roger Maris. His death to cancer at only 51 years of age.
He was a terrific guy and a smile that I'll never forget. The unfortunate thing about it is he didn't have a chance to use that smile many years in New York.
Peter, a very complicated, amazing story even 35 years later. A la David Letterman, though, and his brush with greatness, you actually came in contact with Maris in 1961. What happened?
Absolutely. I was staying at the team hotel. My family took me in there so I could go to the 4 Yankee-Red Sox games. And down, having breakfast at the next table to Maris on the Saturday morning, they had a day game. My mother said, why don't you go get his autograph? And I just, no, left him alone. We left almost just after Maris. He waited in the hallway, came up to me, and he said, look, if you want an autograph, I really appreciate the fact that you wouldn't come over to me while I was having breakfast. And